Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Be Happy Always, Simple Practices for Overcoming Life's Challenges and Living Each Day with Joy, by Xandria Ooi, narrated by Cindy Kay. Chapter 1. Understanding Happiness and Unhappiness. Life is either a celebration or a lesson. Acceptance. My husband, Yuri, likes to say that life is either a celebration or a lesson. I think that this is one of the best philosophies, because then we can truly see life as the gift that it is. Yuri and I have been married since 2010, and we used to argue so much in those first few years. At the time, we didn't know that it was possible to disagree without arguing. We knew that it was common for couples to argue, so we honestly thought that having arguments in a relationship was normal, even healthy. In a way, we weren't unhappy with each other, we were unhappy with the problems. The frustrations we felt toward each other indicated that we must have felt that the other person was the source of the problems. There were differences that created friction every time we tried to talk about issues that arose. It was only when Yuri and I started to see our disagreements as opportunities to learn more about each other that the way we communicated changed. We stopped fighting when we viewed the differences not as problems, but as welcome opportunities to learn more about each other. Not fighting doesn't mean we have no problems in our relationship. It means that we can actually talk about what is wrong without accusing the other person of being at fault. When things are going well in our relationship, it is a celebration. When things aren't going well in our relationship, it's a lesson. Either way, we win. This small but subtle shift in perspective gave our relationship a solid foundation on which to base our work. Because we stopped feeling frustrated when we were unhappy, and we started to instead see our disagreements as a way to help us learn more about ourselves and about each other. This perspective applies to everything in life. We all know that life is never perfect. To be born into this world, to be alive, is to experience challenges and difficulties. We know this, yet we often despair when life isn't going well. We know that people are not perfect, that to be human is to err. Yet when people behave badly and show us their imperfections, we can get really upset. When we really think about it, we start to wonder what it is that causes us so much unhappiness. Is it people? Is it the circumstances? Or is it our reluctance to accept the reality of what being alive means? If we can accept that life is either a celebration or a lesson, then our perspective toward our personal challenges and difficulties will shift. This doesn't mean that we will never feel sad or upset. It means that when we do have problems, we are able to see them as opportunities to learn something valuable about ourselves. When I was producing and hosting on a radio station, I would often come home really upset from the challenges I was facing with people at work. One day, Yuri said to me,
"Didn't you say that one of your goals in life is to grow as a person? Well, the universe must have heard you, because it has given you this challenge to learn from and grow."
That stopped all my moaning, complaining, and feelings of self-pity. It got me thinking. He was right. If life does not present us with challenges, how are we to grow as people? If we are never tested, how will we know the level of our strength? My challenges with my coworkers didn't disappear overnight, but my perspective on those challenges completely changed. My problems were not problems anymore. They turned into welcome challenges. The situation had not changed, yet my feelings toward the situation had shifted, which made such a difference in my happiness. When I look back at that challenging time in my life, I'm in awe of how much it taught me about patience and understanding. I learned how to recognize my ego and to practice the art of letting go. Of course, when I was going through the difficult times, it didn't feel like the situation was something to appreciate. However, when the circumstances had passed, as all things do, the good and the bad, I told my mom, "Gosh, these are lessons that I would have paid to learn." When things are going smoothly in our lives, it's a celebration. When challenges present themselves in the form of either people or our circumstances, it's an opportunity to learn. Either way, we win. This means that we are in acceptance of what is happening, not because we have no choice, but because we know it truly benefits us. Life is either a celebration or a lesson. This worldview provides a solid foundation for every challenge that comes our way because it encourages acceptance. Acceptance is the foundation of our happiness, much like how a structure with a solid foundation will stand strong through the worst storms. Without acceptance as our solid foundation, it will be very difficult for us to be happy or fulfilled no matter what we do or how hard we try to make things better on the surface. We will be too consumed by what is happening to us to focus our attention on resolving our problems and moving forward. Acceptance helps us face what is happening in our lives without wishing for reality to be different. It helps us acknowledge what we feel without wishing we were feeling something else. It is knowing that while we cannot change the reality, we have complete power over how we respond to our challenges. Acceptance helps ground us to weather the storms that will inevitably come our way. Where there is acceptance, there is a lack of suffering. And ultimately, happiness is simply a lack of suffering. People can cause us pain, but we can choose not to suffer. Acceptance. After 32 years of marriage, my dad came home one day and told my mom that he had fallen in love with someone else. It was close to midnight, and I was packing for a friend's wedding in Hong Kong when my mom called with the news. There are some moments in life you remember vividly, and this was one of them. My mom said, "Girl, your dad just told me that he's met someone and he wants to be with her." We didn't see it coming, especially my brother. My parents had had a wonderful relationship when we were growing up, and we had always been a close-knit family. It wasn't a case of pretending that everything was smooth on the surface while things were falling apart. My parents were genuine partners in every aspect of life, raising us as a team, and even running a catering business and a bookshop together for more than 2 decades. Yet, when we thought about it, we could see that it wasn't out of the blue. After my dad had decided to sell his business and retire, he started to be discontented with life. Perhaps he felt a loss of a sense of identity, and it became harder for him to feel fulfilled and significant without a clear purpose. My mom had a career, and my brother and I were grown and didn't need him like we had when we were younger. It had been hard for my dad to be happy. So, although his affair took us by surprise, it wasn't completely surprising. The night my dad made his announcement, I told my friend I couldn't make it to her wedding after all. Instead of driving to the airport, I went to my parents' house. Emotions were running high, and there certainly were a lot of tears, but it wasn't frantic or loud. We were talking openly and trying to process and understand what had happened and why. My dad earnestly told us that the reason he hadn't told the family sooner was because he wasn't sure if the relationship with the other woman would work out long term. My brother Sean, who was 20 at the time, was still attending university. It was the most upset and probably most expressive I've ever seen him. He didn't shout or raise his voice, but with a quiet rage, he told my dad, "You punished me for telling a lie when I was young. You made me promise not to lie ever again. And now you do this." By this, my brother meant my dad hiding his intentions about his trip overseas, pretending it was for business, yet all the while making arrangements to meet a woman whom he had been courting over the internet. We were all blindsided by my father's affair, but in a way, I think it was my brother who felt the most betrayed. Clearly, my dad had done something that had a chain reaction effect on the rest of his family, but I don't think he comprehended how he had just upended my brother's world. I was older, and in the last few years before his affair, my mother and I had had many conversations with my dad about happiness, mindset, and gratitude in hopes of lifting him up from his discontentment. So in a way, it was easier for me to see my dad as a person, separate from his role as a father. But for my brother, had always viewed my dad as a father, strong and always right. And so for him, the very foundation on which his world rested was suddenly no longer solid. When you feel like your father has betrayed you, your world changes. I think my brother lost the last of that innocence that kids have about the world being black and white. He grew up overnight. At times like these, families can fall apart, and there can be a great deal of anger and blame. However, this didn't happen for one single reason. My mom. Where my dad shocked us with his news, my mom blew us away with her grace. My mom responded to the entire divorce in a way that made us respect her on a whole new level. Some of us lose our minds when we get upset and lose sight of what's important to us. But not my mom. She was definitely hurt and upset, but she wasn't angry or vindictive. She never once thought my dad was a terrible person for what he'd done. For my mom, what my dad did was painful, but she believed that only she could choose whether or not to suffer. To her, being angry would be to suffer, and she didn't want that. Her priority was her happiness and the happiness of her children, not what my dad did or didn't do. We'd known our mom to be kind and extremely wise from the way she raised us. People usually show us who they are when they have to go through a difficult time. And through our parents' divorce, we kept seeing evidence of our mom's kindness and wisdom. When my dad was in the process of moving out from our house, my mom helped him pack. My dad wanted more time, but my mom was very firm about him moving out within a week, and she saw that the process would go more quickly if she helped with the packing. My brother and I watched with complete fascination and a little dismay as she packed my dad's clothes neatly into boxes, even going so far as to label them. My brother objected to my dad taking anything other than his clothes. But unbeknownst to us at the time, my mom had given my dad a set of kitchen utensils and cutleries for his new place. It wasn't just one plate and a spoon, fork, and knife. It was a set of six. Because what if he had guests over? Our jaws dropped when she told us this years later. "Even in the movies, you don't see people doing that," my brother exclaimed. At the time, we both protested that my mom was being too nice to my dad. "People usually just throw everything into garbage bags and dump them outside," I pointed out, exasperated. It was as if we had to remind my mom that she was the victim here. And then it really hit me. Why would we want my mom to think that she was a victim when she didn't see herself as one? It does not take strength to hate someone. It takes strength to be kind to them even when they have done you a bad turn. My mom wasn't forcing herself to be nice or kind. She has always been a nice and kind person. While my mom certainly didn't think that my dad respected her and his actions, she respected herself enough not to behave in a way that was beneath her standards. Just because someone has been unkind did not mean she had to also be unkind. My mom saw no reason to let a negative experience change her for the worse. Through the entire divorce process, my mom wasn't controlling or suppressing her emotions. She felt all sorts of emotions, but she did the same thing she had been practicing all her life whenever she was upset. She let go of the feeling. Ever since I can remember, my mom has always been someone who believes that anger solves nothing and creates more suffering. My dad may have left, but my mom did not let that change her for the worse or make her bitter. Often, when marriages end and one parent blames the other, it makes it very difficult for the kids to be happy because they feel like they have to be just as angry as a show of support to the injured party. But because of the classy and graceful way my mom handled my dad's affair and the divorce, my brother and I didn't see it as something negative or bad. In fact, it was incredibly inspiring to bear witness to how my mother handled this difficult time in her life. She had always taught me to be happy, but through her own actions, I could actually see what non-suffering meant. From the very beginning, my mom accepted the reality of what was happening without going down the path of, "How could you?" or "Why me?" In the absence of blame or self-pity, my mom suffered very little, if at all.
my mom has shown me what it truly means to be a strong person. People can always cause us pain, but we truly can choose not to suffer. We can value our happiness so much that even when people hurt us, we don't have to give our happiness away. We can always choose, but never control, our happiness. Acceptance. Most of us know that happiness goes beyond a feeling, that happiness is a choice. However, sometimes we just don't feel good despite wanting to make the choice to be happy. Sometimes we wake up feeling depressed or anxious, and the knowledge that happiness is a choice can make us feel even more depressed because we feel that we have failed in some way. We feel even more frustrated at our inability to make the choice to be happy. But here's what is important to understand. Making a choice is not the same as having control. One of the main reasons we feel frustrated at not being able to be happy is because we think our happiness is something we can control. The problem with trying to control our lives and how we feel is that we will rarely or never succeed because we cannot control what happens to us. And to a great extent, we cannot control how we feel. Our emotions are tied to good news and bad news, likes and dislikes, love and pain. To say that we shouldn't feel a certain way is to deny our humanity. Every emotion we feel is part of being human. To be human with grace, we need to accept that we are full of thoughts, ideas, and emotions that make us capable of extreme greatness, as well as incredible sorrow. Life takes us where it wants to take us, and the best thing we can do for ourselves is to make the choice to influence, to steer, to drive it. But we can only do that if we're not fighting against our own thoughts and our emotions. When people talk about the secret of happiness, they're not talking about how we can constantly feel pleasure and elation, but how we can be in a state of contentment and peace. To be at peace is to look at all the bad things fully in the face and say, "I'm not going to fight you." When we feel we need to protect ourselves, our instincts are always to resist. We feel that resisting means we are not giving up. But it's in fact the opposite. Resisting what we feel makes it even harder to be happy because we're constantly feeling guilty for feeling bad. In a way, the unwillingness to accept how we feel means we are rejecting ourselves over and over again, making it very hard for us to see the value of our lives. This is where all of us have to know that accepting our own negativity, sadness, or depression is not giving up. Giving acceptance to ourselves is giving kindness. It's giving understanding. It's not saying, "You've ruined your own life because you can't feel happy." Acceptance is saying, "It's okay. Breath by breath, you can try again tomorrow." All of us have experienced moments of deep sadness and negativity. We have days where we feel down without any real reason why. If we can be kind to ourselves during these moments, instead of being frustrated at ourselves, it's already a step forward. What's so crucial for us to understand is that moving forward in life isn't about never taking steps backwards. Sometimes we move 3 steps forward and 5 steps back. It can be incredibly frustrating because we feel like we've tried so hard to climb up, only to slide back down again. But that's not failing. That's simply living. We understand that no one is perfect. So why are we so hard on ourselves during the times when we are not perfect? So often, we think we must control our emotions. We must control our lives. But control is only an illusion. That's why our efforts to control almost always backfire, and we end up feeling worse. In life, we cannot control how we feel or how things happen, but we have absolute power over the way we respond to them. Choosing happiness is not about controlling our emotions. It's not suddenly going from feeling sad to feeling happy the next moment. When we choose happiness, it means we understand that the value of our lives is never defined by how we feel at that moment. We don't look at people who are unhappy and think that their lives are worthless.
don't just practice kindness toward others, and don't learn to only love others. When we practice accepting the entirety of what makes us us, the good times and the not so good times, it means we are practicing loving kindness toward ourselves. Depression is not our identity. Acceptance. My late maternal grandmother was extremely poor, and she had to work tirelessly to feed her family of 10 children. I remember my mom telling me how she grew up in a rubber plantation where she and the elder siblings would wake a few hours before sunrise and take turns accompanying my grandmother out into the rubber plantation to tap rubber. Home was tiny quarters on the plantation provided by the plantation owner. When my mom was in high school, my maternal grandparents moved and started running a coffee shop business in the small town of Malacca, Malaysia. My grandmother would cook and sell chicken rice, economy rice, simple fare consisting of a variety of Chinese-style dishes, perhaps better known as chap fun, fried mihun, rice vermicelli, and nasi lemak, a fragrant rice dish cooked in coconut milk accompanied by condiments. My grandfather would make bao from scratch, a Chinese steamed pastry delicacy. He would knead the dough by hand and patiently cook the different sweet and savory fillings nestled within the delicious buns. The buns are similar to what you would find in a dim sum restaurant, but my grandfather's steaming baos were sold to neighbors and friends, with the help of his children knocking door to door. Home was then a small flat where all 10 siblings slept on a makeshift bed made out of desks pushed together. "You slept on a desk?" I later asked my mom in disbelief. It's interesting how something so hard for me to imagine was so normal for my mom. I couldn't stop thinking about how uncomfortable it must have been to use desks as beds, but it wasn't even an issue for her. The family was poor all through my mom's growing up years, yet my mom remembers having had a really happy childhood. Happy as they were, things were not easy, and in fact, were often extremely difficult. They were always trying to make ends meet. My late grandfather was asthmatic, and when he had an asthma attack, which was often, he couldn't go to work. My grandmother was the backbone of the family and the business, and she never took any breaks. She worked through all 10 pregnancies and was always right back on her feet right after giving birth. There was no luxurious time to take a proper rest, as one should after childbirth. All this took a toll on my grandmother's health. She suffered from a constant stream of bodily aches and pains in her later years. She also suffered through a severe menopause, feeling listlessness and entering a deep depression. Without knowing at the time it was menopause that was causing this discomfort, the family tried to cheer her up, taking turns to be with her so she wasn't alone, and helping her to think positively. It was only later that the family learned what menopause was. Thinking positively didn't really help because it wasn't her mind that was causing her to feel depressed. It was her body. The moment they understood this, they sought professional help for my grandmother. This was when I saw what acceptance means when it comes to depression. Nobody tried to fix my grandmother because they didn't see her as anything that was broken. My grandmother herself didn't fight against it once she understood what it was. I know my grandmother lived with pain almost daily, either physically or psychologically, but I never once heard her complain. Whenever we would feel sad to see her in pain, she would say, "There's nothing to feel sad about. This is part of growing old." My grandmother was human, so she clearly must have felt every single emotion, but whenever she experienced pain, she had always accepted it as something she had to go through as part of her life. My grandmother never went to school. She never read books or lived beyond the life she created for her family. Yet she has this infinite wisdom that always came from deep within. I don't think my grandmother actively practiced acceptance as an intentional way of doing things. It was just the kind of person she was. She didn't complain. She didn't pity herself. She wasn't pretending to be happy or sitting around wishing things were different. To her, what was happening was simply what was happening, and she took joy in the smallest things in life. My grandmother may have suffered physically, but because she accepted her situation, she was able to go through life with peace of mind and live each day with happiness. Later, my mom too went through menopause.
I was staying with my mom then, so it was literally closer to home, and I could see how difficult some days were for my mom. Yet, like my grandmother, my mom was able to accept the waves of depression that came with menopause. Even now, when she has days that aren't particularly good, she just tells herself that her feelings of depression are a hormonal imbalance caused by menopause, and that this is just another part of her life process. When we think about fighting depression, fighting for survival, or fighting for happiness, it is almost instinctive to fight with the refusal to accept our circumstances. Acceptance can be seen as weak or passive, but in truth, it takes someone extremely strong to accept a situation they cannot change and learn to find a way around that. A fighting spirit comes not from resistance, but acceptance. This is because our fight against our negative emotions and the challenges we face isn't about crashing against the waves and going against the current. The way to fight successfully lies in the ability to accept the situation and the reality of what is happening, without the if-onlys and what-ifs. We might not like our reality, but we should understand that if we keep wishing that our reality was different, it doesn't mean that we're actually fighting it. It means that we're resisting. We cannot be focused on being strong or moving forward when we're occupied with pushing back. My mom fought her depression, but she did it by accepting it and telling herself that it was just temporary. My mom explained to me that while she might be feeling depressed, she was not in depression. To her, this was a very important difference. My mom accepted her feelings of depression, but not for one second did she allow depression to be her identity. There was no denial or resistance to how she felt during that time, and because of that, it was easier for her to see that she was more than her depression. Acceptance is the best way to win a fight. Winning in life isn't about achieving a goal or reaching a destination. Winning in life is about having a quality of life while we are pursuing our goals and dreams. Our quality of life is much more linked to our peace of mind than what it is we have or don't have. This is the main reason why my grandmother and mother are able to feel depressed yet happy at the same time, because they see that happiness is more than a feeling. It is a state of peace and contentment. Both of these women are an inspiration, as they are an example of how we can all always value ourselves, no matter how we feel. It's okay to be not okay. Acceptance. When we're physically injured, everyone can see it. Most people will even have sympathy for a physical injury, like when we have a broken arm or leg. But when we're mentally and emotionally hurt, it's something that people cannot see. And because of the lack of tangible evidence, it is so much harder to actually explain and justify our unhappiness, even to ourselves. No one thinks that they're not normal when they have a fever, yet we'll ask ourselves if we're not normal when we feel depressed. One of the problems with happiness is the way we view unhappiness. We seem to see unhappiness as not normal, but there is no normal state of being. To be human is to experience all emotions, happiness and sadness, joy and grief. So many of us think that when we're not happy, something is wrong. We take note of the times we feel sad, down, and depressed, and we allow these experiences and feelings to make us believe that our life isn't very valuable. We don't think it consciously, but the despair we feel comes from a sense of worthlessness, where it becomes hard to see the meaning of our lives. We do not look down upon a child born without arms or a person who is deaf. We don't pity them or treat them with disdain. We see them as they are, human beings who can make choices about how they want to live their lives. So why would we see our own sadness or depression as a disability that is crippling us? It's just part of who we are. There's nothing wrong with us when we don't feel happy. No matter how dark the days get, no matter how difficult it is just to get through another day, remember that you are human, and that human beings have to face and resolve many issues in life. Sometimes we have to live with the issues we cannot solve. One thing is clear. The solutions to problems,
including those of physical and mental pain, don't come from hating ourselves or hating our own lives. There is always a reason for the sadness we feel, and we need to examine the source. If it's something we can work on ourselves, then we can practice letting go and removing what is stopping us from being able to access our happiness. If it's not something we can do on our own, we can seek professional help. When you're not feeling well, remember that you are not lacking or stupid or weak. You are human, and your mind or body is telling you that it needs some help, along with a lot of understanding and loving kindness from you. I talked about this with my mom, who faces a few health challenges in life that causes her pain and physical discomfort. Despite what she experiences, she's always been happy with her life. She faces her challenges by taking actions to put things right and not fighting the situation that already exists. My mom is human, so there are days when she feels emotionally affected and down. Some nights she has anxiety attacks that keep her up. When things are difficult, it is her ability to be able to experience discomfort or pain without suffering that give her the ability to be at peace and to be happy. The choice to not suffer isn't just a feeling, it's a practice. I've seen my mom go through the different stages of acceptance over the years. It takes practice to accept, let go, and be at peace. When we experience hardships, it doesn't matter that we can't immediately change how we feel toward them. We may go through a process of wishing that things were different, and from there, move forward with trying to accept our situation. And then one day, find ourselves able to truly be at peace with something that used to bother us. It is as it is. The practice of acceptance does not start with ignoring the fact that we are unhappy, pretending that we don't feel depressed, nor with brushing away or burying all the difficult emotions we feel. In fact, it's the opposite. We can only make the choice not to suffer if we can fully acknowledge what we're feeling without denial, and most importantly, without guilt, blame, or resentment. Having seen my grandmother and my mom go through this, it is evident that being at peace, even through pain, is not merely wishful thinking, but a definite possibility. This always reminds me of how we all have such a huge capacity to appreciate and value our lives, even when we don't feel our best. Our lives do not become less valuable when we suffer, and this is what we need to remember on the days when it's difficult to be happy. Don't let your definition of happiness be based on the feeling you have when everything is going well and there are no problems. The path on which life takes us is not up to us to dictate and control. Even when we take care of our health, we can still fall ill. Even when we are the nicest and kindest people we are able to be, we can still get hurt. Where there is pleasure, there is always displeasure. Where there is excitement, there is always boredom. Where there is health, there is always, sooner or later, illness as well. Where there is love, there is always heartbreak. That's the way life is. People can support us, but only we can help ourselves. And it starts with being okay with not being okay. When we give ourselves permission to accept the bad days, the negative days, and the depressed days, then we can truly appreciate being alive, no matter the circumstance. We cannot find happiness because it has never been lost. Understanding. When we feel discontented with life, we often want to find happiness. This is why happiness can seem so elusive to so many of us. We're constantly seeking something that cannot be found. But how can we find something that's not lost in the first place? We use the word unhappy when the feeling of happiness is absent. But what we often mean is that we're frustrated or dissatisfied or upset or lost. What's important to know is that when we feel this way, our happiness has not disappeared. Our happiness is still right there. It's just that there are so many difficulties and challenges in life to contend with that they may become barriers that block our access to our happiness. As human beings, it is already part of our instincts to try to be happy when we are unhappy. And this is a major reason why we automatically default to seeking happiness when we are unhappy. This is why it's instinctive for us to seek external pleasure when we're feeling down, because it truly does lift us up for a while. We go away on a holiday and we feel better until we get home. We indulge in retail therapy and we feel better until the bill comes. We finish a pint of ice cream and we feel better until we start to feel fat. Yet at some point, most, if not all of us, recognize that our spike in happiness is temporary, that we almost always feel the same way, if not worse, after we've indulged in the pleasures that life has to offer. The unhappiness lingers, even after we've tried so hard to lift ourselves up. This is because the obstacles that block our access to our happiness firmly remain where they are. It's not that we're not trying to be happy. It's that our efforts are always spent trying to navigate around the obstacles instead of removing them from our path. We get very good at addressing the symptoms of our problem without identifying or understanding the root causes of our unhappiness. What are the barriers between us and our unhappiness? When we look on the surface, the barriers to joy are stressful work situations, painful relationships, and difficult people. But when we look beyond the surface and delve deeper, we will begin to see that it is we ourselves who are blocking the way to our own happiness, with our needs, fears, insecurities, resentment, anger, and all the emotions and expectations that weigh us down because we cannot let go of them. It is always what is unresolved in our hearts and minds that stops us from being able to be at peace. This can sound like bad news, but when you think about it, it's actually a relief. Because when you know that you are the source of what is keeping you away from the happiness in your life, then you know that you are also the person capable of changing it. Even though it can seem scary to take responsibility for our happiness, it's actually empowering. The power we all have over the quality of our lives is immense. Life is not what or who happens to us. It is how we respond to what or who happens to us. And our responses are always a manifestation of our own perspective, needs, and fears. This is why when life is difficult, it doesn't help our happiness to look outside ourselves, because this leads us down the path of seeking happiness externally without understanding ourselves, which means any pleasure gained is short-lived. Because of this, we can feel like we're constantly trying so hard to figure out ways to be happy at work and in our relationships, yet we're ending up feeling frustrated that it's not paying off. Also, in the same way, we can feel like we're putting in so much effort to be nice and understanding, yet still wind up feeling it's never enough. This is why when we're not happy in our job, we change jobs. It's why when we're not happy in a relationship, we find a new relationship. Yet we still continue feeling unhappy. No matter how hard we try, our problems are either still there or they manifest in other ways. It's not that we cannot change jobs or relationships. In fact, we must discern when to exit something that is not healthy for us. But often we don't know whether to stay or when to leave because we don't understand ourselves well enough. If we don't thoroughly understand ourselves, we will always be trying to find happiness externally. Feeling unhappy is part of life. And when we are unhappy, it's important not to merely seek happiness, but to uncover the layers upon layers of what is blocking our access to our happiness. And that requires us to look within. If we don't understand ourselves, we'll keep blaming people and circumstances for causing our unhappiness, and we won't be able to truly identify the root of what is holding us back. We'll keep feeling frustrated and angry and jealous and resentful and guilty and shameful without the awareness that we can release ourselves from all these barriers because the roadblocks to our happiness are internal. If we keep looking outwards when we have problems, if we keep thinking that it is other people or the environment that are the problem, then we will find ourselves repeating the same pattern of unhappiness and discontentment over and over again. We won't be able to be happy no matter where we work or how wonderful our relationship partner is. What helps us identify and remove the barriers to our happiness is to look within to understand why we are allowing people and circumstance to have such a negative impact on us. This is when our minds have the clarity to see that our reactions to people and circumstances are often driven by our insecurities, fears, needs, expectations, judgments, self-righteousness, and so much more. If we don't recognize that our happiness has always been with us, we will end up seeking happiness in the form of emotions, and we'll try to constantly create the feeling of pleasure, euphoria, or elation. We may even search for happiness like it's a goal or something to be achieved. Yet no matter how hard we search, if we are not willing to work on ourselves, we won't be able to access our happiness no matter where we go, whom we're with, or what we do. This is why we can have the most amazing careers and the most loving families, yet feel unfulfilled in life. In life, it doesn't bode well for us to seek more happiness to replace the unhappiness we feel. Inner peace just doesn't work that way. There is no antidote in the outside world for the unhappiness we feel deep within. Things will happen to us, and people will affect us, but only we have absolute power over the joy we have. This helps us understand that while things may not be our fault, our happiness is always our responsibility. No matter who or what happens in our lives, it really helps to understand that our joy has not disappeared. The work isn't to find happiness, but to remove the barriers to be able to deal with our own suffering and unhappiness. Peace is something that only we can give ourselves. Self-criticism is not self-improvement. Self-love. Looking inward to identify the barriers to our happiness isn't about beating ourselves up. Taking responsibility for our own happiness is not about blaming ourselves. It's not about willingly taking on guilt and thinking, "It's my fault," or "I'm so stupid." It's really important to understand that self-improvement is not self-criticism. Taking responsibility for our own happiness is about letting go of the concept of blame altogether, both toward others and toward ourselves. Because this means we truly understand and accept that our difficulties are part and parcel of being alive. If we are critical of ourselves, it's harder for us to be honest about our needs and fears. When we receive criticism, even from ourselves, the natural reaction is defense. We defend ourselves against ourselves without even realizing it. What this means is that it's very easy to be in denial about where we need to improve as people because we don't feel safe enough to be honest with ourselves. How can you feel sufficiently safe to be honest with yourself when you're always judging yourself? This is why even when we genuinely want to improve ourselves, we can find it so difficult. We want to transform, yet part of us blocks it out. We're resisting change even while we're desiring change. So criticizing ourselves only seems like a good tool for improvement, while it is in fact detrimental to being a better person. We can also think we are improving, while in reality we are regressing, because our self-protective mechanism has kicked in to prevent us from seeing our own flaws. Some of us think we're self-aware, but we're actually in denial. Although it may seem counterintuitive, it is not self-criticism, but self-acceptance that is key to self-improvement. When we can accept ourselves, it means that we are not subconsciously judging ourselves or being resentful of who we are. This means we feel safe enough to be honest and acknowledge our shortcomings and weaknesses, and that we do not feel so guilty and ashamed that we have to block them out or make excuses for ourselves.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.